Welcome back to everybody. It is my great pleasure to introduce Andrea Floris for the keynote presentation of, no, this is the last talk of today. And Andrea is a professor at Lincoln, Department of Chemistry, and we've been working for some years now. And
Yes.
he comes from Cagliari, but has worked in many groups, including Hardy Bros Groups in Berlin, and also with Alessandro De Vita at King's College,
Also,
Lev Kantorovich, also in King's, before joining the physics and the chemistry and being course. And today he will speak about the calculation of phonons and electron phonon trapping using the Hubbard corrected function.
Thank you very much, Matteo. Thanks a lot for inviting me, Matteo and Emily, Andrea and Nicola. So today I will present very quite briefly the calculation of phonons and electron phonon coupling using the DFT plus U. We have seen in the school that the phonons are crucial quantities to calculate many other quantities, and electron phonon is also important in many aspects, including superconductivity. And let me start.
Take them off and just speak anywhere.
Sorry?
Take them off. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
So essentially, let me start immediately saying that when you have SP materials, phonon calculations are typically extremely accurate. So you have seen probably the second day the talk of Professor Giannozzi, where phonon calculations are really on top of the experiment for germanium, silicon, and aluminum, and materials like this. What about vibrational properties in materials that contain D or F systems, D or F electrons? Essentially, there is a poor description of these vibrational properties if we use standard DFT, where for standard I mean local density approximation, GGA approximation, essentially. Okay. So, one case of this is the case of the transition metal monoxide, which where the phonon can, for example, this is manganese oxide. This is an experiment, and this is a DFT calculation. So you can have frequencies that are even 20 millev off with respect to the experiment. This is a real problem. And also here, for example, and other frequencies instead are in line with the experiment. So there is a sort of selective discrepancy with respect to the experiment. Also, other systems like cobalt oxide and nickel oxide. Also, cuprate ITCs, you can have, for example, phonon anomalies. So this is a phonon, this is the experiment, an anomaly like this. This is standard DFT, so you miss completely the anomaly. And also materials containing, for example, iron and nickel, materials that are of geophysical interest can be very poorly described by standard DFT in terms of vibrations. And also, for example, energy materials for batteries containing lithium, cobalt, etc., they can be very problematic. What is the reason of this? The reason, as you have seen today extensively, I think, is that D or F system already at the electronic level are in standard DFT described very poorly. So the DFT bands we know that are not supposed to reproduce the excitations and the real spectrum of the system. But while for let's say SP materials, the band gap is in DFT is 50% wrong, so it's basically half what it should be. Here in the F system, there is a qualitative failure. For example, a magnetic insulator, which can have, I don't know, 3, 5 electron volt of gap, can be described as a metal. Also, we have seen the example of cobalt oxide. Let's say that the gap is like this is described as a metal. This is a clear disaster at the electronic level, but it's also a disaster in terms of vibration. Because if you think about atoms which vibrate against a metallic screening, a Fermi screening, you know, you have certain frequencies. If instead the vibration is done in an environment which is insulating, the frequency can be differently renormalized, they are different. So then this is the reason. So one possibility, as we have seen today, is to describe the electronic level with the DFT plus U method, and the DFT plus U plus D method. And then let's say this is a method which I just summarize here corrects the standard DFT here. So you have the total energy of DFT, and you add essentially an Hubbard correction at the total energy level, which has this expression. So I will not repeat the theory of DFT plus U. I just mentioned here the expressions that we need to modify to calculate then the formula. So this is essentially a set. This is the first expression. This is the Hubbard energy, a set of concave down corrections. So that you can recover. So in exact terms, you have the total energy that is a linear piecewise curve with respect to the total occupation. Well, instead, the DAGGA gives you a parabola. This correction here adds basically concave up parabola in order to recover somehow the exact behavior of the total energy with respect to the number of particles, and then to recover this sort of behavior and eliminate the spurious self-interaction which characterizes the DAGGA. Eliminating the self-interaction means that basically, if you have self-interaction, the d electron, the f electrons, to reduce this self-interaction, they spread. Okay, they reduce it. But if you eliminate the self-interaction, they can be more localized because they don't need to be spread in order to avoid this problem. So that's why essentially DFT plus U can localize better the electrons, and then you can open the gap essentially in this scheme here. So DFT plus U is a mechanism to opening the gap in many systems. One important point, so these occupations that you see here, essentially these N occupations, are essentially you associate occupation to this D electrons, to the five orbitals of D electrons, for example, by introducing these matrices here, N. So what you do, essentially, you take the block states, the psi, nk, sigma block states, which are generally delocalized, you sum over them, you sum over the occupied block states. So this is basically a Fermi Dirac distribution. And you project them onto this basis, which is localized. Localized, so that means that is explicitly dependent on the position of the Hubbard atom. In this way, you can, given this basis, which is somehow arbitrary, but it's a basis, you can construct occupations for these orbitals here. And then every orbital or every d orbital will have associated an occupation. And in the two spin channels, spin up and spin down. Okay, so I think that you have seen this already today. Another point of the theory is that DFT plus U is that the Cohn-Sham, so this was the total energy. Now we go to the Cohn-Sham description, and with respect to the standard Cohn-Sham spin resolver, you add a potential, which is the Hubbard potential, with a different quantity from the total energy potential. So essentially, this potential looks like this. It's something that is essentially this one here acts on the on a specific block function, so a specific energy, corresponding energy band, via this projector here. So it's a non-local potential, so it's not a multiplicative potential simply like I don't know, this one here, for example, V of R, but it's a non-local, there is an integration here which is involved. And then in this way, basically you selectively push up and down the levels that tends to be half occupied or fractionally occupied, and then in this way you open the gap. I'm not going in too many details here because we know that this was already done. So the two extra terms in DFT plus U are the Hubbard potential and the Hubbard energy, the Hubbard energy. So this introductory part is important to say that these two terms are explicitly dependent on the atomic position, because the phis, which is the fixed basis, not self-consistent, the fixed basis depends on the atomic position, and also the n via the phi again are dependent on the atomic position. This is important because when you take derivatives, this explicit dependence on the positions is very relevant. So what you do to calculate phonons? You introduce a non-periodic wave, essentially a monochromatic wave defined by a vector Q. So you basically deform the system in this way, and then simply speaking, let's say you calculate the second derivative of the total energy with respect to this atomic displacement. This is what you do. Then this gives you access to the dynamical matrices. Then you diagonalize and you obtain the eigenvectors and eigenvalues, which are the phonon frequency essentially. In order to do that, it is very important to compute the perturbation of the density. So basically, the density, you need to compute the perturbation of a density n of r with respect to atomic perturbation. So basically, this is the point. So what we did in collaboration, of course, with Matteo Popoccioni is to combine the DFT plus U, which is important to get the electronic properties right, with the density functional perturbation theory, which is this machinery very powerful to compute phonons and other quantities. And then we did this implementation here to obtain more accurate vibrational properties of DF materials. What are the main advantages? The main advantages, they combine the traditional advantages of density functional perturbation theory. So you don't need supercell calculation. So you can basically treat every Q, every perturbation, even the one which are very close to gamma, so the one that would imply a huge supercell, essentially you treat them at the same computational cost for every Q to the net of symmetries. But as it was discussed, I think a couple of days ago, if you do finite differences, depending on the Q, you have different supercell and you can expect different cost. Here instead, every Q is independent and more or less has the same cost, and you can compute frequency so arbitrary Q. So this means that you can have many Qs, that you can have phonon dispersion, phonon dose, vibrational entropies, electron phonon coupling, Eliasberg functions, etc. And then on top of this, you have all the interpolative schemes based on Vanier, and nowadays you can really make this property converge very well. So you combine this with the advantages, this is rather important here, of the DFT plus U. What is the advantage of DFT plus U? Obviously, there are other theories which can treat the correlation and can provide a better gap than standard DFT, also the hybrids, etc. But the DFT plus U is increasingly popular, in my opinion, because it's computationally very cheap. So the hybrids, for example, cost 10 times, roughly 10 times a standard DFT calculation. DFT plus U at the electronic level is more or less the same as a standard DFT. And this is probably the most important point here for this talk, is rather easy to compute energy derivatives. We need to compute first derivative to obtain the forces and second derivative to obtain the dynamical matrices. While instead, maybe with other functionals, at least in linear response, it's very difficult to have analytical expression of the derivatives. So this is an important advantage of our skill. So let me just start from the beginning. What do? You take the first derivative, which is minus the first derivative is the force. So if you have in mind the expression of the total energy, the derivative of the total energy with respect to atomic position, you have the Hellman-Feynman theorem, so you don't perturb the wave function of the density. So you have the at this level, you don't need to perturb the density. So you perturb only, so you take derivatives or bare derivatives only of the quantities which are explicitly dependent on the position, so the external potential, the nuclear-nuclear interaction, and in addition, the Hubbard energy, because the Hubbard energy we said that is explicitly dependent via the phis on the atomic position. So this is one extra term, which was already implemented by Matteo in Quantum Espresso, which we call Hubbard force. Then for the dynamical matrix, at this point, you need second derivatives. So according to the 2n plus 1 theorem, so n is the order of perturbation of the density. So in order to have essentially the second derivative of the energy, you need to have the first derivative of the density. And so you can have this quantity and also, the third derivative is already for free when you compute the first order density perturbation. So basically we have this, so I just want to not to focus so much on the details, but here you just take the derivative. So you take the second derivative of this one, then the first derivative of the density. So this is our crucial ingredient here. Then you have the second derivative of the nuclear-nuclear interaction, and then you have a sort of mixed second derivative of the Hubbard energy. So basically, essentially, that's it in principle. So this is the Hubbard dynamical matrix, if you want. So the addition, and these two ingredients needs to be computed extra in density functional perturbation theory. So what do you do? What do you do to calculate this perturbed density? This is exactly as in density functional perturbation theory. No details. Just you just need to compute. So if you switch on, if you displace your atoms, you have a different potential, essentially delta V. Okay. Then if you have delta V, you will change all the wave function with delta psi. And if you change all the wave function delta psi, you will have a corresponding change in density, delta n. So you have delta n, delta v, delta psi, that you need to compute self-consistently via this system of Bolster-Neimer equation. And then you arrive to self-consistency. What is the extra point of LDFT plus u? First, now that we have the Hubbard potential, you will have also an extra term of the perturbed Hubbard potential, of course, the first term. The second difference is that in this Hamiltonian here, which was just the Konechan Hamiltonian, you have the Hubbard potential. So this you have these changes here. So you solve the system. So this is what I said now. We said that we have the Hubbard potential, the perturbed Hubbard potential. So you take the Hubbard potential, here this expression that I showed before, and then this is, you just take derivatives here of all the quantities that are present here. You take derivative of the n, derivative of the phi, etc. And then you Also in terms of Abbard energy, when you calculate the dynamical matrix, again, no details here, but you have this expression. There are one thing that I want to mention is that while the first derivative here is, which is the Abbard force, is a bare derivative, so it's a derivative where you don't change the psi and the density, according to the Abbard, to the Hermann-Feynman theorem, this second derivative here is a total differential. So it's a total derivative which contains bare and self-consistent terms. So you need, in this case, to change also the psi. Okay, so the block function and the density. So in this notation here, which is probably different from the one that we use in the paper, bare means that you don't change the block wave function, but only the phis. And SCF means that you change only the block wave function. Okay, so this is an expression that, so this is what I said. This is an expression that is valid for non-conserving pseudo-potentials. It's already complicated, but doable. When you go, as we did, go to ultrasoft pseudo-potential, things get more complicated. I will not enter into detail. So I just mentioned that also PAW, I just mentioned that when you write down this formula, one line of non-conserving formalism corresponds to more or less one page of ultrasoft pseudo-potential, which we are asking ourselves if, I saw the debates around interesting this week, if it's still worth to use ultrasoft because you pay a lot of price in terms of implementation. Obviously, if you have the code, as we have, it's already done, etc. In any case, that's the point. Actually, this was a paper, so it's illustrating this, was a paper that we published recently, also thanks to Yuri Imrov, that really contributed a lot to the finalization and the porting of the code. So I would like to thank him. Okay, so essentially for polarized insulator, you have also, as discussed by Paolo Giannozzi, so longitudinal vibrations and transversal vibrations. So you have the LOTO splitting. I don't want to enter in details here, but for this, so LOTO for polar insulator contribute hugely at gamma. So there is a huge difference. And then I wanted to add something. If you, so you need to be somehow to have a continuity of the phonon branches at gamma. So basically, if you look at phonon frequencies, phonon dispersion with and without LOTO, you have a huge difference because also the frequency around gamma, they have to bend in order to be somehow matching the one gamma. So LOTO splitting is really very, very, very important. So you need to essentially to calculate this this non-analytical term of the dynamical matrix, which corresponds to calculate the dielectric tensor here and the Born effective charges here. So I mentioned this because also in these two terms, this is a bit technical, but you can you have to add the extra contribution. Here, for the dielectric tensor, you need to add basically a commutator between the electrical field, which is basically the position operator, and then non-local Abbard potential. And also for the Z star, you need to compute this expression, this mixed derivative here with respect to the electric field and atomic potential, and you need to consider also the extra U term in the total energy. Okay, so basically summary, this was basically, this is the summary, so you need to add the Abbard dynamical matrix, the perturbed Abbard potential, and for polar insulator, you have a Born effective charge Z star and dielectric tensor. I want to mention also that if you do metals, but DFT plus U for metals is pretty rare, but if you do metals, there are also extra terms coming for metallic correction, very, very technical, but we implemented also that in the code. So now let me just apply these two assistants that we have studied, the same class of this system that we have seen during the hands-on. So basically, manganese oxide, as you know, this is basically a system where you have anti-ferromagnetic planes, so spin up and spin down for manganese, arranged perpendicular to this 1-1-1 direction. So the 1-1-1 direction, this one, if you consider this is a cube, is all the direction of the cube would be equivalent, but because of magnetism, the 1-1 direction is a special direction because the planes are perpendicular to the 1-1-1 direction. So essentially we can see what we obtain. And so this is basically a GGA calculation, so only without U basically. So this is the 1-1-1 direction, which corresponds to this gamma T direction. So what you have? You have here the longitudinal phonon, which in GGA is here, while in the experiment is there, so it's very, very off. And then you have, for example, this branch here, which are two degenerate transverse phonons, so the phonons that vibrate in a degenerate way perpendicular to this direction, and they are degenerate here. While instead, the experiment is basically here. So there is a huge difference. There is an important point also here. So this is a fact. So there is a strong underestimation of certain frequency. And then if you go to this direction here, for example, 1 minus 1, 1, which correspond to this this direction here. So if you consider this direction, these two transverse, so one of these two transverse mode is also transverse to this one. So they are both transverse to this one, but one of the two is transverse to this one and to this one. So you will have continuity here. The other one, TO1 here, will be transverse to this one, but with a component along this one. So you will see these two modes that were degenerate will split, and this is a purely magnetic split. Okay. So as you can see, the GGA gives you a huge magnetic splitting, while instead the magnetic splitting is just this little thing here. So basically what I want to say here is just the take-home message is that, first of all, frequency themselves are strongly underestimated, and also the transverse splitting magnetic splitting are underestimated, and the transverse optical splittings, magnetic splittings are overestimated. So this is the GGA. Let's go to the DFT plus U calculation. With the U calculated ab initio, with as you at that time we didn't have the HP code, but according to this scheme of Matteo and Stefano De Gironcoli. So basically, you see that you recover. This is the longitudinal now. Very much better agreement, and also the magnetic splitting slightly overestimated the center of mass of this, but still the magnetic splitting is similar to the one of the experiment, and also these phones are better. In any case, we recover a strong accuracy with respect to the GGA, GGA only calculation. For cobalt oxide, as you know, we have that cobalt oxide has a similar structure to manganese oxide. There is actually a monoclinic structure, but we model it as a rhomboedral distortion along 1-1-1. This is an insulator. GGA describes it as a metal, so it's really a disaster. And GGA plus U, this time calculated with the HP machinery, gives you a U that is not here, but this is the gap that we obtain, which is in much better agreement with the experiment. So this is the U calculated by Yuri and Matteo. And then So basically, what we have here, we have the gap is much better, it's an insulator, and structurally it's very similar to the experiment. So it's a rhomboedral structure, while GGA gives you a doesn't give you a rhomboedral structure. Also, the dielectric tensor and bond charges are 9%, 16% overestimated, but still acceptable. And just I want to arrive to the conclusion here. So this is the comparison between DFPT only and DFT plus U. So you can see that in DFPT, these are the dashed lines. The structure is unstable, so you have many imaginary phonons, while instead the structure and the DFT plus U phonons are really good, they are all positive, etc. In terms of experiment, you can see that the red curves superpose quite well with the experiment. You have a LO experiment here, which matches with the frequency and frequencies, and also we obtain a generally quite good aggregate. So also in this case, we have we are pretty satisfied. So just methodologically, this calculation are completely ab initio, because you calculated ab initio. This is functional perturbation theory, everything is calculated essentially ab initio. Now let's finish briefly with electron-phonon interaction. Electron-phonon interaction is the last bit of the implementation. Here I just list something that you probably know. So the electron-phonon interaction are typically defined for metals, and you have so this is the lambda, these are the phonon line width. This is the Elias-Bell function. I mean, you have a lot of delta functions because they are quantities for metals defined around the Fermi surface. But actually, one important ingredient is that all this quantity depends on this this object in red, which are the electron phonon matrix elements square. And this, so these are the core essentially of to compute all these quantities. This is the definition of electron phonon matrix elements. It is basically a sandwich between two wave functions and then the perturbed potential delta V. But this time, the perturbed potential delta V contains also the extra contribution, the perturbed upper potential. So we need just to add this to the expression, and we obtain the electron phonon coupling, let's say, modified by the limit. Importantly, these matrix elements are not defined necessarily only around the Fermi level. You can couple every bands you want because they are defined like this. So, for example, you can also calculate electron phonon matrix elements of excited electrons of, for example, a semiconductor or an insulator. So, also a finite temperature. This is what we did in collaboration with Matteo Puccioni, Marco Bernardi, the group of Marco Bernardi and Nicola Mazzari. We exploited the fact that cobalt oxide is a good system that shows a lot of difference with and without U. And then we calculated, let's say, the electron phonon matrix elements for this system. So the blue one are the DFT only, and the red one are the DFT plus U. So there are huge differences here, which can be important. And also, if you want to superpose the electron phonon coupling G nu Q, so resummed over the bands and the K points, and over the bands and a gamma, actually, you can also see that depending on the phonon, the electron phonon is very different. So you have a variety of the structure is very rich, essentially. That's the one. So that's it, essentially. This is the occasion to thank, of course, Matteo Puccioni for his work we did together in solving a lot of issues in the implementation, really with a constructive dialogue, constant. So Yuri Timrov, of course, Then Stefano De Gironcoli, which started the first formulas, analytic formulas was very extremely important. Then Nicola Marzari, and then finally Marco Bernardi. And then I want to mention, to thank also the Materials Chemistry Consortium in United Kingdom, which is a let's say give me access to Archer-2, which is a super machine in Edinburgh. And I thank you for your attention. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Andrea. So the vice chair and Mr. McGurkin setting the start of the question sector. Please.
Thanks a lot, Andrea. Really interesting. So as from what I understood, when you calculate quantum VFT equals new, what you do first is to you have a structure and you calculate the subconsistent PV value from the response, right? And then you have this as a fixed parameter, right? But also to connect with the lecture from uni this morning, we see that as you change your atomic positions, in principle, the consistent value of mu should also change.
Yes.
I wonder if you sort of have a way to allow for this additional degree of freedom in quantum calculation, if you would sort of have an improved description of your quantums, because also it's motivated by in the group of Nicola in Switzerland, we know sort of how to predict with a reasonable value of accuracy the mu parameters as a function of positions. And we do this with equivariant neural networks. And then we were sort of thinking whether this would have any applicability, and then phonons as an idea, as a potential idea. But also, because these models are also automatic differentiable, one thing that we could also get is the derivatives of the U with respect to positions, which is a term that you get when you sort of do the chain rule on your forces, on your energy with respect to the derivative on positions. And then if you do open a calculation, you get this fully term, which is explicitly has to take account of the derivative of the U with respect to positions, which is as far as I'm aware, this is a term that is negligible, that it's actually neglected in the current implementation because we have no way of calculating this subconsistently, but this might help. But I don't know.
You are absolutely right. In principle, the U should be. You should differentiate the U. We don't do it because we were wondering all the time. You could do probably inside the machine of the phonon calculating the U with the HP code, but it becomes problematic. But as far as I know, we never had an expression to differentiate. But I think your comments are very valuable, and we could. I'm not sure how big is that.
Is
the effect compared to you can easily test it. I mean, maybe you can just nobody prevents you to put a U which is arbitrary in your phonon calculation. Then maybe if you change your U of I don't know, half electron volt or so on, you can see how sensitive the system is. But in principle, of course, the U should be changed consistently during when you switch on atomic displacement. You are totally right. We consider that absolutely. So every contribution to this implementation is welcome.
Thank you. So the direct phonon implementation is only for metal, or it also works for magnetic with the velocity.
Well, it depends what you want to do. So you can extract basically the implementation will print something for metals now, things like this, for example, quantities like this, the lambdas and the gammas of quantum expression that are there since many years, right, in several flavors. Yes,
the G are
there At the moment, I think that you to extract the G's is not automatically done. I did it in the past in some version, but is you don't get the G's. These G's were taken from the group of Marco Bernardi, but still as a post processing of our calculation, there was a check basically. But you cannot extract the G squared directly now from the code. However, I know that the electron phonon part will be simplified and rewritten in the future. But this is probably
can be. Can you explain why you get this divergence that was not centered on the group assumed? So you show that
these divergences are.
Yeah.
I think this is related to some.
This is not metallic.
This is an insulator. So this is I think I'm not sure about the details of this divergence here, I don't know this actually. So I just know that you know there were some strong differences. These are not directly my calculations.
The point is that the DFT in blue is metallic.
The point is the DFT in blue is metallic. Yes, so the that's
correct.
You then have the divergence because there is no metallic anymore. Yes, exactly. That's the point.
Okay, Yuri.
Thanks, Andrea. I just want to come back to the previous question about the derivative of U. Especially in statements of machine learning to do that. But just while listening to the talk, I remembered about another way to do it. Actually, Tomas mentioned about this automatic differentiation, which is implemented in DFTK class with an engineer. There's really some mathematician developed some fancy method to do derivatives without analytical formulas.
Okay.
I think that's what we call this can be also interesting.
Yeah, absolutely.
So basically since we don't have analytical expression for the quantum condition, but this method seems to be really the good one to estimate it. So
yes,
we can prove that it's small, like 5% or less. And we can really justify neglecting this. So maybe it depends on the system.
I think it's system dependent. Yeah, but it's a good point. Yeah.
So I was looking at because apparently there is a DMFT implementation in which you can do phonons like this and other. And so I was looking at this paper if they did actually combat oxide. And they didn't. So they did manganese oxide, iron oxide, they did nickel oxide, they didn't do combat oxide, just that's a pity, let's say, but I would say that when they do it, it would be really interesting to compare those phonon bands because so I would stay really tuned because I might get it that they are going to be very similar for very different reasons, let's say, but I might guess it that the electronic structure described by DFT plus U is already a good one, let's say. So I know it because we do our main on the DFT plus U the omega. And we get very similar results than to them. And the thermodynamics is the same with respect to the DFT plus U. So the phones will be the same.
Mm-hmm.
And so I guess that it would be easy if they finally do the cobalt oxide, because I think that the bands will be very, very, very similar. Maybe you know exactly those shifts that you were talking about, they are not super precise. Maybe the DFT can do it, but I think it would be just that.
Yes, but they must be similar because
yeah.
If we agree with the experiment,
yeah, exactly.
there are discrepancies, yes, and there is not
perfect. Yeah.
Also, goethite is not also, maybe you improve some frequency and others are less improved. So the U acts is a little bit, is not always perfect,
mm-hmm.
But it would be interesting to see these results also. Yes, absolutely. Yes.
Small curiosity. So you mentioned several times that you do D and F electron. I'm wondering if you ever tried 4F.
I didn't try 4F on calculation. Mm-hmm. No.
Europe Mosai.
Yeah, no. Yeah, exactly. Yes. It's interesting there.
So, Andrea, thanks a lot for the great talk. So, you mentioned the advantage of DFT32 over hybrid in terms of consumer cost. But I was curious, what's the status of implementing DFT for hybrid functionals? And have you done some?
No, I personally didn't think about it. And
is there?
I don't think it's there. Because what I read, what I discussed with many people would be really a nightmare.
That's
the problem. Also, because my impression is that people are starting to use this sort of machineries for larger system molecules, nanostructure, and then a method like DFT plus U, which was traditionally, maybe, you know, some people consider other methods more sophisticated, instead is gaining points because of this simplicity. Physical is very intuitive. Sometimes it's not easy to understand exactly what is the meaning, but is intuitive, and then you can take derivatives. At least at a non-conserving level, I think it's really easy. The point, as I said, is that when you start to do ultrasoft, then it becomes a little bit complicated, but still feasible.
Thanks, Andrea, for the talk. And I was just wondering how difficult it would be to also extend the formulation to orthatomic orbitals and also to the B correction, since it seems that you already have the machinery to do so.
So I think that for the V is a matter of doing it. Somebody needs to, it is possible to do it. And actually, I think we should really do it. Because now it's not there. For the autoatomic, also there are some extra terms, but it's definitely. So these are the two directions that we. I think people should we can consider to have even more accuracy, because there is space for improvement in the accuracy as well in what we get, as you could see, it's not on top of the experiment something. So there is space. This is doable. These two things are doable.
Yeah, I would recommend a bit to continue upon this session on the on you and the change in the positions. But maybe it's better to do it after the lecture if it made developments very long. So it would seem intuitive that all the vibrations are periodic, and thus if we could assume that the, let's say, variations in U could also be periodic, maybe it would make sense to represent it in some Fourier transform spectra in once we transform this periodicity, and then have a finite sum of discrete values of U in this frequency space, and hopefully be able to express it in an easy way
and
the mathematics.
That's interesting. So you always switch on a periodic perturbation. So you need to, but the U is exactly a perturbation, the local perturbation, not something that you can get from a. Is a concept which is local. Well, here we should essentially compute the U switching on this wave and see, and then you obtain a different U. Basically, for every Q and for every actually phonon, for every phonon mode, you have, in principle, you have a different U. I think it's actually more complicated than I
thought.
It's changing in the sense that the phonon, you have 3n phonons for every Q. So you have 3n displacement for Q. So actually, you would need to compute 3n different U's per perturbation. So it's actually quite, it's the first time that I think about it. Like, actually this time.
But so then that's complicated. The advantage of machine learning, for example, that you get in number three.
Because like, if you can do it in the middle of calculating for single queue every mode, it's fine. I know it's not your question, but it's related somehow.
Yeah.
So if you put on the fly, you know, every time to compute a different view, but you need to be also fast, otherwise it's not gonna be
with binary expressions for people, right? It's completely pretty straightforward. Because you're always generating new configurations with display data. And it's just a matter of changing your reading volume.
It's not that I'm just doing this tutorial. It's more or less nice repeatedly to like minutes, 5 minutes.
No,
you need to do this many times. Really to differentiate with the problem.
Maybe it can be worked out through the HP that already has this queue structure.
Yes.
So the traditions are wavelength specific, and maybe can be worked out from the
human.
Yeah, so maybe you have the U for the perfect lattice, and then you want to compute delta U, basically Q dependent delta U.
Which situation do you expect that leads to the influence on the point? You expect there are situations where a change in the derivative of the U is important for the
iteration. So that's the main question.
Wait, can we follow up on that? I don't know if this helps. So if one takes the parallelism between GW and GP plus Q, where like I said, one also manifest a bit more, and somehow having a constant Q corresponds to having a constant W, that is the approximation that you all the time do, for instance, we go from GW to the Peter, always you keep W constant. So that would correspond to keeping you call, but once you have averaged and made it static and so on. Having a U that varies would correspond to having a W that changes, or taking into account that. So it's not, if one searches for reasons and phases where that matters, one of the things sure. Is there.
I would suggest to continue the discussion. So at the podcast session, we have a little announcement. So we have to move the podcast session from the that courtyard to the one where we have coffee breaks. So you will find before the coffee break, which now has become an apero, you will find the poster. So we're gonna stay there a little bit.